share with us. And I heard these stories, I don't know how long, but over a decade ago, I'm sure. But I found them unique, so I love them. And also, he's going to tell you the humanitarian part of that is about a new thing, which is family's nonprofit that works in Belarus. He'll tell you more about it, or if you want to find out, you can go to their website and all that good stuff. But this channel's in the Christmas spirit if you weren't already. So you're on. I'm off.
People don't understand, I don't think, just how complicated our work is, a shepherd's work. It's hard work, it's long hours, but also there's a science to it. I met a man from Alexandria over in Egypt, university man. He'd never been outside the city before he came to Jerusalem. I was down there in Jerusalem for supplies. And in the course of our conversation, it became clear to me that he thought we shepherds were something like statues, mild-mannered do-nothings, standing peacefully on the hillsides, leaning on our staffs, and looking gentle. That fellow, he could put in 1 week with us working the flocks, and he would either flee for a vacation from all the hard work, or his brain would cramp up from all the information. Or both. Sheep are so stupid. They have to be taken care of in every little detail. Shepherding requires a system. Sheep have no natural defenses. Just about anything can kill and eat a sheep. You have to find pools of water for sheep to drink from because they're scared of noisy, fast-moving water. You have to feed the flock all year long, even though the climate changes and the food sources change. You have to have a place for feeding indoors and out. Your stable needs to face east so it gets earliest sunlight of the day, and it needs to be situated on a slope or it's a real pain to clean out. And it's got to be kept clean and dry because moisture rots a sheep's wool and a sheep's hooves. When a ewe is ready to give birth, you have to segregate her. Or when a sheep is sick, you need to put it in a pen by itself. But if you've got the flock out to pasture, you need another strategy, which is why us shepherds carry so much gear. The picture that university fellow from Alexandria had in his head, where we were just standing there in flowing robes with nothing but a staff, that's hilarious. But we carry wicker hurdles. Some shepherds use a type of netting, but I prefer the wicker hurdles, they're called, to keep the sheep separated. And then from season to season, you feed sheep on different schedules. In the summertime, you drive them out to the pasture at daybreak because the grass is dewy and the sheep will eat more than at midday when the grass is dried out. About noon, you move them to a shady place under rocks or trees and let them lie down, and then they'll graze again in the evening until sunset. And you have to guide the flock to stand facing a certain direction while they're eating. A sheep should always graze with the sun behind it, don't you know? Its head is very sensitive to heat, but it's too dumb to turn around on its own. Then at sunset, you lead the flock back to water and let them graze again because by now the grass is good again. But after the autumn equinox, the schedule's completely different. After the harvest, you want the flock eating the stubble because consuming all that shattered grain will fatten them up for winter. And besides, it improves the land for the next year's planting because their manure gets trampled into the straw. And then in the winter and spring, you have a different system again. You let them sleep in, wait till the frost is off, then drive them out for one long all-day feeding with just one watering about noon, and that's all they need in that part of the year. Now, you want to know about breeding? What time of year and what you feed the rams and what kind of water the ewes have to drink and how old they have to be? Do you realize that a ewe can trample her own lamb in the middle of the night if you don't keep them separate? And for a while, starting at about 10 days of age, lambs have to be tethered apart from each other because when they play together, they injure each other. I can also tell you how to get a lamb to nurse, because some lambs won't do it on their own. And yet, 4 months later, when they're being weaned, some lambs have to be taught to eat, because if you don't, they will die of starvation. And then with adults, you have to be careful where they eat and for how long, because a sheep will eat anything, healthy or not, and will keep on eating till it explodes if you don't stop it. I'm telling you, sheep are dumb. Shepherds are smart. Sheep and shepherds are alike in one major way. We're dirt. That, I think, is why people look down on us shepherds. And look down on is not strong enough language. People in the city despise us. We're like lepers to them. Outcasts. You think I'm exaggerating? We can't go into the temple. The religious leaders, the Pharisees, you know, won't let us. We would defile it. Because we've been out in the fields, or in the pens and the barns, working in the dirt and the manure and all the bodily fluids that happen when you deal with animals. Of course, there are ceremonial washings that you can go through, according to the religious authorities. But they're so complicated and time-consuming that it's hardly possible for a working shepherd. And I would say, from my own experience on those few occasions when I've tried to qualify, that the Pharisees evaluate us more critically than they do people from other professions. They know you're a shepherd. And they scowl and squint and sigh and send you back to try again. They call it being ceremonially unclean. In fact, anybody who comes in contact with us is regarded as unclean, dirty before God. No shepherd has ever been part of a religious establishment. It's unthinkable. Because they say, God considers us dirty. Shepherds aren't even allowed to be witnesses in court because we're so detestable to God. Which I don't understand. Father Abraham was a shepherd. Moses was a shepherd. King David was a shepherd. I think those are pretty good credentials. I might even say there's a pattern here. God approves of the dirty ones. He chooses the dirty ones. He uses the dirty ones. But in my world, with the Pharisees in charge of the temple, well, nobody was asking the dirty man's opinion about dirty men. And I confess I finally gave up. Gave up trying, gave up caring. I was born a shepherd, I'll die a shepherd. I can't meet the religious standards. Can't get clean. Can't spend my life in high anxiety about it. I know there's God. I learned about God. I believe. I recognize God as creator, the master of life. I want to please Him, want to serve Him, but just unworkable for me. So, we were out in the fields, my group and I. You want one shepherd for every 100 short-haired sheep. If you've got fine wool sheep, they need more attention, so you'd only want 50 sheep to a shepherd, but we had short hairs. So we had a good flock, about 500 sheep. So there were five of us, Ziba, Gera, Shabbatai, Joppa, and me. It was that time of the year when you just live out in the fields, you don't go home, it would be too complicated, which frankly is why so many shepherds have a bad family life or no family life. Can't keep a wife that way, at least not a good wife. So after the season, when you go into town, you find someone, and I know it's not a great way to live, but it's how we live. Anyway, we were out in the fields. We had no clue, no warning that something was about to happen, no idea that anything out of the ordinary was coming. And it was dark. It was nighttime. You don't expect a blaze of light, like a huge fire or something, to suddenly light up the world. We had the flock in a kind of meadow. We called it Jehoshaphat's Gully. It's a joke, but that's for another story entirely. But we liked to keep the flock there at night because there were natural barriers around on three sides, rocks on two sides, and kind of a cliff on the third side, and the sheep would more or less stay put. You could get by with two guys awake and three guys sleeping, and you sleep in shifts. So, I was awake. Maybe dozing. I don't really know anymore for sure. And Ziba was awake. And all of a sudden, there was this light, like daylight, but only in one small place. And this guy is standing there. I remember thinking, just for a split second, how did he sneak up on us? It was like there was a huge torchlight on him, except he wasn't carrying a torch. It was more like the light was coming from inside him. Honestly, I would tell you, I'd like to tell you that I handled it well, but the truth is, this guy appeared and I said, "Ah!" So loud I woke up the other three. They stirred, they started up, they were grabbing their sticks and their weapons. I thought we were dead. I thought this guy, this creature, whatever, was going to kill us. It was that weird. We five were making noise, we're scrambling around. And yet, in the midst of all this commotion, not one single sheep stirred. And then the guy opens his mouth. He says, "Don't be afraid." And his voice is strong, but it's calm. It's not like a command, "Don't be afraid, I'll rip your head off." It's like genuine. And even though I'm squinting at him, my eyes are still trying to adjust to the light. I can see his face is not the face of an attacker. He's almost smiling at us. So he says, "I bring you good news of great joy." And my guys finally settling down a little, standing still, because this guy, this angel or whatever he is, isn't coming after us, obviously. "Good news of great joy," he says, "that will be for all the people." And I remember thinking, in that split second, what in the world is he talking about? I look at my guys, they're looking at me and at each other. There's a moment there where we're just waiting. And finally this guy starts telling us this sort of story. "Today," he says, "in the town of David," and gestures down toward Bethlehem, "a Savior has been born to you." And I'm thinking, a Savior? What do we need to be saved from? And frankly, furthermore, if he's just been born, how's he going to help us get away from anything? Yeah. But then the guy says, "He's the Christ." I mean, he was speaking Aramaic, if that was our language. But the word he used was the word for Messiah in the Hebrew. In Greek, you say Christ. Either way, it means the anointed one, which is what we all learned. We learned all along, someday God would send the anointed one, the Messiah, to set his people free. I mean, to hear that term, Christ, to hear this fellow say that Christ had finally come, but he had just been born, that was a bizarre moment. It was beyond believable. It was almost absurd. But I think he knew we were going to think it was weird, because then he said there would be a sign, a guarantee. He said, you'll find a babe wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. A manger, a feed trough. Totally bizarre. You don't find babies in feed troughs. But before I could say, you don't find a baby in a feed trough, the entire meadow lit up like daylight. Hundreds of these same kind of angel fellows were suddenly standing there and looked to me like every sleeping sheep had an angel standing next to it. And yet, not a single sheep woke up. They were as calm as could be. It was just the shepherds who were getting hysterical. And now, all the angels began speaking in unison like a choir, except sounding like they really meant it. Glory to God in the highest, they said, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests. And then, bam, every one of them left the ground. They floated up. Their light went with them. They faded into the night sky. I looked at Ziva and the others. My eyes took a minute to adjust to the darkness. Jotham had tears in his eyes. He was so shook up. Shabbatai was just blinking with his mouth wide open. Nobody said anything. What could you say? It was the most freakish experience any of us had ever had or even heard of. Until finally, I guess Gira collected his wits enough to say, come on, let's go to Bethlehem and see what's happened. God sent these angels, he said. They didn't come from Athens. Let's do what they said to do. So we left Jotham with the sheep. He was so rattled he could hardly speak anyway, and the sheep were completely quiet. And we headed down into town. We didn't walk. We ran. This wasn't like trying to shake off your middle of the night fatigue. It was like we had early morning energy. We raced down into Bethlehem. It took us about an hour and a half. We figured the local innkeeper would know if anyone in town had delivered a baby that day. My experience is that in every town, the innkeeper has the most and the most immediate information. And if not the innkeeper, then the innkeeper's wife. So you can always find the inn near the entrance to the town. Sure enough, there it was, tiny place, stone base on the house. And then come to find out, the baby was right there, not in the inn, in the barn out back. The inn was full. The parents of the baby had to stay in the barn, and the baby had actually been born in there. I couldn't help but notice the stench as the innkeeper's wife led us toward the barn. Worse than just the usual animal and feed smells, I would say they were not keeping up on the cleaning schedule. As she pulled the handle of the barn door, the innkeeper's wife muttered to us, I know it's not good. My husband's been sick. My sons have all left town, and I've been keeping up with the business. In other words, rather, they were not keeping up on the cleanings. Inside, with one unsteady lamp burning, I could see cobwebs strung from the beams and rafters. Under my feet, I felt the slick slime of animal waste. In one corner, there was kind of a makeshift sitting area with a milking stool and a workbench. You could see where someone had raked the rectangle clear, and a couple of blankets were spread out in the cleared area. A man was on his feet, signaling us to be quiet, gesturing toward the floor. A woman was sleeping on the blankets. And there he was, baby boy, also sleeping. Normal looking, wrapped up in fabric the way they do. Exactly the way the angel had told us. It appeared that somebody had found the freshest hay, actually I would say the least filthy hay, to fashion the feeding trough into a sort of bed. You don't find a baby in a feeding trough, and yet, here he was. It had to be true that this little baby was the Christ, which I know is unbelievable because we all thought the Messiah would arrive with swords flashing and take over the country by force. But after an angel appears to you, and then 500 angels appear to you, and after the impossible prediction they make to you comes true, when you find a baby in a feed trough, you don't have much in the way of second thoughts. You just take it at face value. For some reason, God chose to send Messiah to be born in a barn, to sleep in a feed trough. As dirty as I've gotten in my life, I can tell you I've never slept in a feed trough. Never known anybody to sleep in a feed trough. Never heard of a child being born in a barn, actually, except this one. Imagine if the angels had given the news to some Pharisees and they had turned up in such a place, they would have gone to pieces. Actually, sometimes I wonder if the angels did try the religious leaders first, but when they got a whiff of the place, they said, "No thanks, this is highly irregular, probably a sham." So the angels came to us. Well, we weren't quiet enough. We were talking too loud, I think. The mother stirred, and at about the same moment, the baby's eyes blinked open. The woman sat up. I whispered, "Sorry." But she smiled at us. And now that the baby was waking up, and I felt free to get in a little closer, I stooped down beside the manger, slipped my finger in under the baby's palm. His parents didn't seem to mind. Here we were, still smelling a sheep, more like this wretched barn than they were. But they seemed comfortable with me touching the baby. I looked at the mother again, decided to take a chance. Gestured into the manger with both my hands and said, "May I?" And she nodded. So I slipped my fingers, dirt under the nails, the wrinkles in my skin permanently ground. I slipped my fingers under the baby's head and under his little bob, and I lifted him up out of the feed trough. Spray scrawl was hanging down from the fabric they'd wrapped him in. I drew him close to my face. His eyes weren't even focusing yet. He was just looking out into space, blinking, silent, and pulling his face close to mine. I kissed his cheek. miserable barb. His skin smelled that perfect baby smell. And it stunned me in that moment. It suddenly just suddenly hit me, and I almost couldn't breathe for a second that this grimy shepherd had touched the hand of God, looked into the eyes of God, kissed the face of God. Not years from now, after I've died and gone to heaven, not even in the temple, the holy place. No, right here. Right now. In a foul, dank farmhouse. And he had called me to him here. To a place where I fit right in. God hadn't come as a military general or a rich man or a celebrity. He came weak and needy. Holding that fragile little fellow, I realized the very strange thing God had decided. I had expected a hero, a conqueror, someone to meet all my needs, but he decided to turn everything around. He decided to need me. Well, before we couldn't talk about anything else, we told everybody we saw the next day and for weeks afterwards. People were amazed by the story. They could see in our faces we weren't crazy, that we were telling the truth. God had sent an angel, hundreds of angels, and they had told us the Messiah had finally arrived. God had given us a sign so we could go. It was true. Everything checked out. It was real. But it was a pretty incredible story, don't you think? People's eyes would just get wide. They would shake their heads. And as you walked away, you would sense that they were trying to figure out whether to really buy it or not. It was well into the next day when we got up. Four of the four of us got back to our box. Jotham was pacing back and forth, wondering what had happened. We finally got him settled down. But here's the strange thing. Those sheep were completely at peace. They slept through the night. When they woke up, they grazed. Jotham was in a frenzy, but the sheep were happy. I don't know what else to tell you. I can tell you from that day to this, I don't feel dirty. Not before God, I don't. He didn't choose Caesar to get the news first. He didn't choose Herod. He didn't choose the Sanhedrin. Or even that university fellow from Alexandria. He chose us. Wretched workers. Outcasts. Quote unquote, unclean people to be the first to know. He chose our life, a life of dirt, smelly and ugly, for Messiah to live. I don't know why. We had nothing to offer in the way of gifts, and he certainly didn't get any extra status for having us as his first visitors. It made no sense for a Messiah to arrive in such a foul place. He could have done way better. But I guess somehow, for some reason, God decided that regular, everyday, ordinary people, even ugly, dirty, unloved people, should have a chance. So he would start out life in the middle of the mess. Right where we were. Since that night, I've had Pharisees challenge me on the story. But I know what I know. I know it makes the religious types a little crazy, but Messiah didn't come in through the religious door. He came in through the barn door. that barn, reeking of filth, looking at that little guy sleeping on soiled hay and that sad wooden feed trough. I confess, I thought to myself, this doesn't look like a Messiah. This doesn't even look like a religious leader. Actually, to tell you the truth, I think he'd probably make a good shepherd. My wife and I started a ministry called New Thing 20 years or so ago. We basically support a sister organization in Belarus, former Soviet Union, which we translate from the Russian as Responsive Heart. So we support a Responsive Heart team that's entirely Belarusian, and we fund the acquisition and distribution of about 200 tons of humanitarian aid a year for people in need all over that country. Orphans, children abused and abandoned in shelters, hospital patients, the elderly. We serve as hospitals and boarding schools for children with disabilities, organizations devoted to adults with disabilities of various kinds, and so forth. Just by God's grace and others deciding not to work in Belarus, our team is now the biggest humanitarian aid operation in the country. And I would like to take you with me to Belarus without your ever leaving home. Every Tuesday, almost every Tuesday, I send out photos and updates from our work there so that you can meet the kids and the people that are helping. These photos that are on rotation on the laptop take you there, and this is the kind of stuff that you get in your inbox if you're on our email list. And I want to give you an opportunity to get there. So I have a piece of high-tech sign-up technology, and that is this yellow pad. You want to put your name and email address here under my name and email address, you may, and or just hand it to the next person. There's a pen to hang to pass along, and likewise back here, starting with George, take that pen, hand it off when you're done. And after we're done this evening, if you want to talk about Belarus, I'm always happy to talk about Belarus. Before COVID, my wife and I were over there two or three, sometimes four times a year. COVID really shut that stuff down. And there are special problems in Belarus that we won't get into this evening, but we're eager for people to look at what's happening over there and forward those emails, pass them along, share them on social media, whatever. Love to get you looking at what's happening there. And this evening is designed to benefit New Thing, our work in Belarus, and your local way station, Ministry of the Homeless. But I bring you good news, because after Pastor Gail invited us here, my wife and I decided that we would like to inspire you to give generously to the local work with the homeless. The work here in the county. So anything you leave in the donation basket this evening for the work of the homeless here in the county, we will match So we'd like you to be as generous as possible. The work that is happening through this church and others in the county to support and help people who are struggling with homelessness is hugely important. I was involved in helping homeless families in Essex County, Mass. when I first moved to the area, and believe strongly in what you all are doing to support homeless people. So, I encourage you to give generously, and we will celebrate the opportunity to be involved in that. One more bit of good news. I come there and guess. I wrote a goofy book about my little town, Ipswich, Massachusetts. Everything in here could just as easily be about Jackson, New Hampshire. And I write a humor column for the local paper and post online these columns, and I've been at this for 10 plus years. So after 10 years, I took the funniest ones, or let's say the least unfunny ones, and I put them in a book and drew cartoons to illustrate them. And put them in a book and put a little bit at the back about our work in Belarus, so that if you have the book, you have information about the work in Belarus. Clever little do-si-do. And you can't buy this book. You can only receive it as a gift. So everybody here gets one to see. And if you don't like it, you can give it to somebody you don't like. And one for home, one for work, or something. And seriously, if you think there's somebody who might enjoy it, you can take more to see them on your way out. Take them and give them away. The more people who get the book, the more people look at new things working on Belarus, and I'm all about that. So. Now, let me read you another story, but it's not exactly a story. It's more of a scene, and it's between two people, and so I have to play both characters. And I pulled this out of my files for you because I thought you might like it, but it goes back 25 years. You have to go back in time with me now. Before the internet, back when we relied on fax machines, back when our culture was all about like Ninja Turtles, remember that era? We're talking about like mid-90s or something. Was that? So, this story is called Christmas Incorporated, and it takes place in Santa's office. Santa and his head elf. Start with Santa.
Myron, Myron, Myron. We've been through this 1,000 times. Look, the pressure flow goes Santa, kid, parent, see? The parent buys the expensive toy under pressure from the kid. The kid requests the expensive toy under pressure from the department store Santa. It starts with the Santa. If the Santa doesn't push the new Super Supremo Legos construction kit with laser module software, the kid doesn't beg his parents for the new Super Supremo Legos construction kit with Legos module software. And if the kid doesn't beg his parents for the new Super Supremo Legos construction kit with laser module software, then the parent doesn't buy the new Super Supremo Legos. The parent just buys a Doki Pops with crayons or something. That's what the parent buys. The profits go right into that little bucket under the Christmas tree. Morning. Get in here, okay? Myron, I got overhead. I gotta keep the heat on at the North Pole, you got it?
What do you mean?
How promotion, the Santas pressure the kids. They're salesmen, aren't they? Oh, man, look, have them use the old sees you when you're sleeping, knows when you're awake threat. That usually seems to do the trick. All right, Myron, don't make me call you again on this. It's pressure, 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 got it? Santas to parents to kids. Now go for it, babe. Ciao. Myron's getting up soft in his old age. What can I do?
You can do whatever you want, boss. You're Santa Claus.
I mean, how can I help it? I didn't want Christmas to get like this. When I started out, I had a little shop out behind my house. A few part-time migrant workers rushed the old sled. How was I supposed to know this idea was going to take off like this? Suddenly, I got a multi-billion dollar business on my hands. I didn't even finish high school.
You want to see me about something, boss?
Yeah, you got feedback yet on the price increase in the toys division?
Yeah, the guy that there, Schwartz, says no problem as long as there's an upscale logo on the product that baby boomer customers will buy. The guy at Toys R Us gave me some trouble over. I told him he'd better pay or we cut off his supply of Ninja Turtles.
Warning! Does it come to this?
Boss, we gotta keep our position in the marketplace. Cutting off his turtles is nothing. Last Christmas, Playworld gave us a hard time. We blew up their ship in a party in France.
Good grief. Christmas is really out of control. Look what I've become, Morty. I started out as a kind, generous man who just wanted to relieve the sufferings of those around me. But somehow it all snowballed. The Gen Xers and their Starbucks cards. The Wall Street junkies with their Christmas profit margins. Separation of church and state lawsuits. And today, I'm just a figurehead. I got no control over this. I've become the very embodiment of all the excesses of human nature.
I didn't quite follow that, boss. Something about you not happy with your body? You can work out a little. We can put a treadmill in here.
Okay, you can go. No more cutting off anybody's turtles, for heaven's sake.
Does this mean you don't want that guy from Playworld to wake up with a reindeer head in his bed?
Boy, get out! Hello, Claus here. Oh, hi. No, I'm going to have to work late again. Well, it's Christmas time, for Pete's sake, Margaret. I'm Santa Claus. What am I supposed to do, subcontract to the Easter Bunny?
You got a fax, boss.
And, you know, a lot of wives would be happy with their husbands hitting a gig in business like this. Oh, no. I need this like I need another government safety regulation. It's a fax from God. If I wasn't in trouble before, I am now. It's probably filing suit against me for illegally cornering the Christmas market. Oh, that's fine, Margaret. Side with him. I'm only your husband. Thank you very much, dear. I'll see you when I get home. Santa Claus, North Boulevard, purchase order 17054. Purchase order. He's placing an order. Please deliver a customized gift pack in my name to the addresses on the following pages. Customized gift pack. Morty, do we offer something called a customized gift pack?
Yeah, boss. It's part of our 21st century promo campaign. You describe it, you pay for it, we'll deliver it. Hey, look at this, that fax you got, it just keeps coming. It's about 50 pages long already. Just a bunch of names and addresses. It's like a list of everybody in the world.
Please deliver the story of my son's birth with this beautiful message of peace, this warm expression of hope, his genuine qualities of love and compassion. Please include all the joy that you feel when you realize someone loves you enough to give up his own son for you. Quantity of this order, 7.7 billion souls.
trouble. The Elks are already getting double time and a half for all this overtime.
No, Morty, under the delivery date it says ASAP, urgent this gift, gets to everybody quickly. But if you need more time to get it out, go ahead and spend the rest of your life on it.
That's good, huh? Standing order.
Morty, this means more than business. This means reorganizing our whole operation.
Gee whiz, boss, it must be a lot of money if you're talking like that.
It is big, Morty, but it's not money. It says here the order was paid in full, in advance, 2,000 years ago, in the Holy Land, on a hill called Calvary.
2,000 years, boss? I didn't know you was half that old.
Morty, it's over. Send the elves home to the forest, or wherever it is they live. Put the reindeer in the stable, give them some fresh hay, and put How the Grinch Stole Christmas on Netflix for them.
Boss, we got orders to get out.
No, we don't. However many Harry and David sausage packs we shipped, that's enough. However many mission accomplished G.I. Joe kits we delivered, that's enough. However many gift subscriptions to Sports Illustrated we mailed, along with the embarrassing swimsuit issue, that's more than enough.
But boss,
no, Morty. Christmas shouldn't rise and fall with inventory of Miley Cyrus twerking pull toys, or back orders of the new holographic edition of Monopoly. That's not how it started out, and that's not how it's going to stay. We're going to take this whole next year off.
A year off?
And we're going to restructure. No more Gift of the Magi, mud wrestling, tournament, gift certificates.
But we'll lose our Ashley Madison sponsorship.
No more Deck the Halls daiquiri specials at Chili's.
But we'll lose our commission on the bar tabs.
No more Megabucks Christmas credit promotions at Bank of America.
But we'll lose all the kickbacks we've been getting from the Treasury Department.
Too bad. None of that stuff is what Christmas is about. Christmas is about somebody who loved us so much, he sent us a little baby as a Christmas present. A baby who will grow up and show us what love really is. Something strong enough to really help us and heal us and give us hope. That's going to be our Christmas message. From now on, get the word out, Morty. We'll have a staff meeting at 10 a.m. the day after New Year. I'm going home to my wife. I'm going to give her a great big hug and pour her a great big cup of cocoa and sit down with her in front of a great big crackling fireplace and smooch with her. Ciao.
Pressure's finally got to him, I think. Put two or three of your toughest boys on this. Dad, Donner, and Blitzen are okay. But Rudolph makes the hit. That's just a goofy little story from the 90s. I think he gets the work to do the turtle thing. Story, and then we can do Q&A if you have any cues. We'll see if I have any A's.
It was the day after Christmas. All through the town, there were signs that the season had nearly wound down. The overcast past the sky, draped the city in gray, as if anxious to drive Christmas spirit away. The sidewalks were icy and risky in places, a challenge to any pedestrian's graces. The policemen at corners and the drivers of buses were cranky at all being such unlucky cusses that they were the ones who were back on the beat after only one day spent away from the street. Cars parked downtown in the holiday crush were all spattered with mud and with goop and with slush. It was the day after Christmas. The lights were still lit along State Street. They had not been altered a bit, and yet this day, the day after Christmas, they seemed to hang limp and unhappy. But once they had. It was into this scene that a gentleman came, as he had every day of the year, just the same. An older man, stooped by his dozens of years, in a cap that pulled down to protect both his ears, and a scarf that had served him since Roosevelt's day, and a coat made of wool in the old-fashioned way, and a pair of gray pants, slightly baggy, of course, and a pair of brown shoes from some long-forgotten source. He shuffled along in a most careful pace, as he did every day on his way to the place where he'd worked for so long, no one else could recall if there'd been a time he was not there at all. At one place on the street, the old man turned aside through department store doors, and he shuffled inside to his window between ladies' jewelry and paints, where for years he had handled refunds. On this day after Christmas, the old man looked out from his window and saw what the season was about. The wreckage of last-minute sales in the store had strewn gobs of litter across the whole floor. A lady's wear mannequin lay in a corner, her head broken off, and no family to mourn her. The shelves that were empty were stark and forlorn. Where goods did remain, they'd been wrinkled or torn or broken or cracked or destroyed in some way by stampeding shoppers on the last shopping day. And the old man, he frowned at this world that had roared. For Christmas to him was the birth of our Lord, the day when our Savior we paused to remember, not just the 25th day of December. So sad, he observed, that this message was muffled, and Jesus had gotten quite lost in the shuffle. It was the day after Christmas, and precisely at 10, the doors were thrown open for business again, and now, as the old man looked out from his place, the shoppers came in, as if running a race for the day after Christmas. The sales are so that you must get there first, like a good shopper would. And for those who are smart and whose thinking is clear, these sale items can be good gifts for next year. Two ladies fought over a tree ornament that had just been marked down by some 50%. Unsold Christmas cards were reduced to a song, and likewise poinsettias that wouldn't last long. The gift wrap. Candles and cards were reduced to give year-end sales statistics a boost. And all through the stores, the consumers were crawling like ants at a pigment as prices were falling. And lost in the squeeze, overwhelmed by the din, was the meaning and message that Christmas had. And before long, the old man was busy himself, almost as if he were the post-Christmas elf. For many a person had come to complain about Santa's work with degrees of disdain. A fat woman plumped down her box with a thud and said, "This present turned out to be a real dud. I bought my young grandson a Bible, but he would rather get something more useful from me. So let me exchange this and take him a toy that would really be more apropos for a boy."
was sad down inside as the cash drawer was shut. A man came in blustering, muttering, mad, saying, "This was the worst Christmas I've ever had! My daughter was crying all night just because she discovered that I was the real Santa Claus. My kid was this nerd in the school Christmas play. I want to go home now," is all he would say. A Christmas tree fell on the dog, and besides, I forgot to buy film, so there will be no slides. My wife is just furious, so are kids. This Christmas has put my whole life on the skids. But now, if you'd like to hear more, I'll arrange it. This diamond watch doesn't work right. Please exchange it. The old man behind the complaint window sighed, for this chap had nothing of Christmas inside. And then he prayed silently, watching him go.
"Oh, Lord, where's the Christmas then? I used to know. When your birth was recalled, when tears came to eyes, as the sacrifice made was again realized, and hearts full of joy turned to heaven in praise, and the spirit of love filled the city for days."
Abruptly, a noise broke through the man's prayer. He looked up at a furious customer there.
"It's broken!"
she spat as she threw down the bag.
"I want a full refund, and I brought you the tag. It's a wind-up nativity scene that won't run. Besides, if it did, it would not be much fun. I ordered a Santa with wind-up reindeer. But your store sent me this, and that's why I'm here. Look, I'm in a hurry. I really must dash. Don't make an exchange. Just give me the cash."
The old man reached in with a grasp that was sure for the scene of Christ's birth done in miniature. He held it before him, his old eyes still keen as they looked at that tiny nativity scene. The wise men were standing just off to one side. The reins of their camel had come all untied. Their gifts had come open, spilled just a bit. So the old man quite lovingly corrected it. The shepherds who once had been kneeling were not. They had fallen, so the old man put each in its spot. The woman impatiently took in the sight as the old man took care to make everything right. She wanted to rush him, but she stood still instead as she saw the warm glow around the old fellow's head. His fingers replaced tiny Mary with care, and then stood tiny Joseph right next to her there. And the customer watched him, transfixed by the love that she saw in this old man, but knew little of. And then for a moment, his face clouded up, his mouth tightened slightly, his brow wrinkled up, his eyes were exploring the scene with great care, for something was missing that should have been there. In the place where the Christ child normally lay was a manger with nothing inside it but hay. The scene was so tiny. The Christ child would be quite small anyway, and then perhaps hard to see. But the old man looked closer, and no, he was right. There was no baby Jesus. No Christ child in sight. The customer, waiting, was watching in awe as the old man set out to correct what he saw. He drew the nativity scene to his face, and his eyes began searching each square inch of space. His forefinger gently inspected the hay to make sure that the babe wasn't hidden that way. He drew back the robe of each figure to see
if beneath one of them Christ's child could be. The cattle were carefully moved and replaced as he looked for the baby who had been misplaced. And just as his heart almost gave up the cause, the lady observing him saw the man pause, and then across his face a warm smile broke out, the reason of which there, of course, was no doubt. And as she looked up, the old man took a stable and carefully then he peeled off the Christ label. And there, in the grasp of a pricing tag's glue, was the baby called Jesus. And as good as new, then gently, back into the manger, he laid the tiny Christ child for whom it was made. "They covered you up," the old man whispered low, "with all of their buying and selling, you know. There's still some of us who are seeking your face, and we'll just keep on putting you back in your place. The manger is empty for millions, I guess. There's no manger at all for most of the rest. Christmas is only a day off with pay, unless Jesus is born in your heart on that day."
The old man looked up for the very first time and saw that the woman was still there in line and listening to the opinions of his voice. He noticed her eyes, they were gleaming, moist, where once she was hard, now her face was serene as she reached out and took the nativity scene. And holding close like a treasure, she went. For she understood now what the manger scene meant. The manger is empty for millions, I guess. There's no manger at all for most of the rest. Christmas. Unless Jesus is born in your heart. The old man checked out at the end of the day and, as usual, shuffled off going this way. But I have to believe the Lord Jesus looked down from the throne room of heaven on the whole town. Of course, he could see all the holiday crush. Cars parked downtown in the mud and the slush, and he saw all the cops and drivers and buses all cranky at these unlucky cousins. And I'm sure the Lord saw that on State Street it seemed all the lights hung forlornly where once they had gleamed. And he saw all the people who wanted to fight for the stuff that had been marked down overnight. And I'm sure the Lord saw the gray sky overhead that just made Christmas spirit seem totally dead. But beyond all of that, I believe in this that old man walked home through the weather outside. And I have to believe that all of the time, the Lord Jesus singled him out, reached him, and touched the old man in a beautiful way for the true Christmas love he expressed on that day. It was the day after Christmas, but only a start. The Christ child was born once again in history. The manger is empty for millions, I guess. There's no manger at all for those of the best. Christmas is only a day off the dead, unless Jesus.